All right, we're gonna give this video thing another shake. So this is the painting that we're gonna do today. It's called I Dream of a Mountain. This really lush, kind of surreal landscape, dreamy landscape. The colors that we will start with, as we're gonna move this aside and get down to business. So the basic colors we're gonna start with are gonna be an orange, a light orange, a pink, and a white. The brushes that you'll need, again, based on whatever you have access to, anything will kind of do, but I am working with a 1-inch flat. We'll use a round, any size, a 6 or an 8 size round. And then the one that has a little angle, or a saber brush. If you have an angled brush that's kind of looks more flat, that looks like that it's on an angle, that's called a shader, and that will do. But again, you're kind of making do with what you got. And the other is we want to do a liner brush for detail work. That's just the skinny brush. So again, the idea is working light to dark. Although working with video, when we stop and take pauses, if you need to change your water, you could definitely change your water. So anyhow, we're going to get down to business on I Dream of a Mountain, which theoretically anything in the middle of this could have been I Dream of Anything. So if you wanted to do a grilled cheese sandwich or an Austin Martin or anything, you could probably do that. But I'm going to do a mountain. So what we're going to do is that the clouds that kind of make that dreamy kind of sequence around. But we want to kind of start mapping out some of the sections of the painting, because these are kind of little complex little sections of the painting, but don't sweat it, because we'll take it step by step. So the first thing that we're going to do is we kind of want to like always kind of define your horizon line with, I'm using the angle brush or the saber brush, because for me there's a lot of versatility there. I can do a skinny stroke, I can do a broad stroke. Just like I say at events, whatever brush that you feel comfortable with drawing, if that's the little skinny liner brush, if that's the round brush, or even the big brush, that's something that you can use. But I'm going to use my angle brush. So after I kind of made my horizon line, I'm going to kind of map my little cotton candy clouds about there. I ain't worried about how opaque or necessarily how thick that line is. It doesn't have to be that thick of an outline. So what did I do? 1, 2, 3, maybe 4, 5, 6 little shapes that kind of look like, again, this really puffy little cloud shape. Even though the top half is going to be orange, I'm going to kind of stick with that pink a second, because I'm just, like I said, mapping out and drawing. I'm going to start right from the center. Maybe 2 little puffs. And this other one's going to be kind of a weird shape that's going to kind of come over and curl off the page. So again, what that's going to look like is a puff, another little puff, and then off of that second puff, I'm going to kind of make this little jut that comes out over, this little line that kind of comes out over. Off of that line, I'm making this sharp little ridge. Thank you. Okay. Also, I'm going to try to map out this little area down here. There's just other little ridge of clouds, and I'm going to kind of just kind of swirl. Same thing, even though that this is going to be a little orange section, I'm going to kind of give another little section of smaller section of clouds. Something not right about that. Kind of always making corrections on the go here, I guess. Right? Is it that? Which is fine as you're painting. There's just something that wasn't striking me right. Okay, so we're going to pick it up from the spot that the other video left off. We're going to kind of begin to fill in the pink cloud first and begin to give some body to this. As we kind of go through the paintings, you're going to find little areas that you needed to fix. So up in here, I kind of wanted to kind of redefine some of my lines. You can do the same thing with even the size of your swirls and your puffy clouds, or what are going to be your puffy clouds. You wanted to make some bigger, you wanted to make some smaller, you know, you can make those corrections. And that's kind of actually one of the advantages of doing stuff on video. You can pause and start when you need to. I'm going to switch to my flat brush because I need to get some nice broad strokes. So I'm going to take a little of that pink and begin to work some of these pink clouds. And I'm going to kind of start from the lowest point in the corner and just begin to paddle in some of that pink. The white that we're going to use is going to play a part too, because that's going to kind of give a nice softness to the edges and kind of give some definition. But now we'll just kind of fill in. And at some point I'm probably going to need more paint because I'm kind of going through this relatively quick. Again, it's like playing a song based on how you use your brush, the colors you're using, how hard you, the pressure point that you're using on your brush will always be a little different. Will be exactly the same, but we'll try to get a facsimile of the painting that we're doing. Speaking of, while I get more pink, speaking of songs, how I came up with I Dream of a Mountain. I hate titling paintings in general. And I feel like when I finish paintings, I could easily title them after songs. And this one would have definitely been Misty Mountain Hop by Led Zeppelin, but I refrained. I just said, I'll dream a mountain. So, all right, I'm going to paddle that. Again, don't sweat if you're streaking or drips or anything. It's not that big of a deal. So with that flat brush and how I'm kind of getting these feathery strokes is just little semicircles, just like when you were drawing it out. And then we're going to give more definition to these with white to kind of make them creamy. Give them that cotton candy kind of feel. And again, a lot of this in the is going to be covered up when we actually put in our trees and all that. So with some of that pink still on my flat brush, I'm going to kind of move into some white. And I'm going to begin to give some edges to some of these shapes. Instead of kind of giving it like cotton candy, I'm slowing my brush down and getting some nice coverage. Taking a little bit more white. Just lightly pulling that white down into the pink. Barely touching the canvas. Now we're going to get into that orange in a minute. Actually, for a minute while we have that pink, there's this little ridge of clouds at the base of the mountain. I'm going to switch brushes. I'm going to move to my round brush for a minute. And I'm going to kind of do the same thing. I just want to kind of fill in this, give myself some notes as to how these clouds are going to lay in this background and kind of shape the bottom of that mountain. So clouds are kind of important to this particular piece. That's what's giving it its dreamy, surreal feel. Same thing, I'm taking a little white, I'm going back and forth. After I get that pink, I'm almost making like little bubbles, little swirls with the white paint. It's got some pink on it. Just blending those together. Actually, I feel pretty good about adding just that little, again, barely touching the canvas. Okay. You said we can come back to this and polish this up however we need it to be later, if we feel so compelled. All right. So I'm going to do the same concept, except this time I'm going to use a little orange. So I'm going to kind of stick with my brush, and it may have some residual pink in there. That's okay. I'm wringing that out the best I can. If you're really compelled, then you could use paper towel or whatever, rag or whatever that you're using to kind of get all the water out of there, so that you don't get any accidental drips. So I'm going to take a dollop of that orange. I'm going to start at an edge. And again, something that you do at home, and I've said this at all my classes, if doing the sides and the tops of your painting is something that's important to you to kind of give a finished look, you can do that. I'm not going to. So I'm taking that orange just along the top. That means it should be recording. Okay. Gave myself some notes, so I'm going to kind of follow those notes, but I'm going to kind of fill in a little of this orange, even where that was pink. I'm going to kind of begin to just So we're gonna have white come and make these really soft pastel clouds. We need a little bit more water. I think we did this painting one time before at an event. I actually wish we would do it more. This is kind of secretly one of my favorite in the catalog. Okay. See, what's nice is once you put the pink in there initially, you're always going to have that ridge. And it's going to kind of show you, kind of stay in the lines there with the orange. But this is going to be a dark color, so we're not going to fret that just yet. Okay, so even like we did the pink, with that orange on there, I'm going to go grab some white. I'm going to begin to feather that in. Along the orange. While that orange is still wet. All right, we want to do this little section down here while we still have orange. So again, I'm going to follow my little lines that I started in pink. Kind of tone them in orange now. Swirl that in a little bit. Take a little white. And I'm going to kind of make those a little puffier. Again, I'm just swirling my brush. And if you want a little bit more orange, then we can add a little bit more orange. And I think I'm going to do that. I'm going to grab a little more. Again, the whole thing with this is you may need to switch brushes kind of frequently. You have to kind of get in some of the defined lines and tight spaces. I just grabbed a little bit more of that. I'm gonna switch to my liner brush for a second. Kind of get down in here with some of this white. Moving back to my round, getting the water out of there. There you go, getting the orange that I wanted. Okay. I just want a little separation between the pink and the orange here. Okay. good with that, I suppose. I would say I'm good with that and then put, you know, another bunch of strokes down. Because that's how I roll. And just to be cute, take some orange on my liner brush. Maybe just give a little. Okay, so now we're going to do the background. Because it's kind of like this midnight blue kind of thing happening here. So I usually do work light to dark, but in this instance, I want to kind of begin to define this darkest edge. And I'm using my flat. Again, if you feel that using your saber brush or your round brush is a better way to go, that's fine. But I feel pretty confident with my big flat brush. Get closer to those edges. I start at that edge and I just begin to push out. And I can come back in with a smaller brush and kind of take care of all that when I need to. Almost making a wing. And I'm doing that by not using necessarily the broad side of the brush. I mean, there's a couple of those strokes, but I'm also using the edge of the brush to kind of get those sharp lines. This weird little area up here, I'm gonna kind of go back in there. So about halfway in, they're halfway through that big shape. I'm going to switch to that light blue. Got a lighter blue there. I'm going to begin to work that in slowly. I want to get speckles all over my cotton candy clouds over here. So I'm going kind of slow. Again, you can use a little broad end of the brush, get some edges by using the edge of the brush. Now down here, we're probably definitely going to have to switch brushes to kind of get in and around all these little curls of this cloud. But I just want to kind of in fact, if I want some of these areas darker, I may even go in and give a second coat of dark blue or phthalo blue. If I haven't shown you what colors those two blues, that was a dark blue, a phthalo blue. If you have something that you got some store-bought tube of apple barrel paint or something, if it's a navy blue or a midnight blue, any sort of dark blue will do. And then sky blue. So as I get back down into these little tight areas in here, I'm going to switch to my saber brush again. If you got paper towel or something, you want to make sure that all the water's out of your bristles or out of your ferrule. Otherwise, you might get some unexpected drips. And usually I say don't sweat the drips. But in this instance, you want to be a little neater. Otherwise, you got to go back and repeat the step where you're doing your clouds. And you're only going to be able to do that by having to put a whole lot of white down and go rework that. So Again, with your saber brush, you can get these nice little thin lines, and you get a broad side of that brush too to kind of blend that in slow. And even before you put the mountain in there, the theater, I guess, if you're thinking about it, but that mountain is going to live. It's already starting to look really bright. And we're going to add white in a second to kind of almost make it seem like shooting stars. Be tactful when you're putting water on a saber brush. It holds a lot of moisture. So again, you're kind of trying to be careful of the drips. I'm gonna try to get down as close as I can. Even though you can get a pretty good line, it's all about having the leverage to kind of make the line quality that you need. Some of you might be working flat. If that works for you, you might have a little bit better, like I said, leverage over how you're painting. I'm gonna take a little of that light blue, and now I can kind of get in tight around those pink cotton candy clouds. You may have blue. Well, I guess the assumption is that you're going to have whatever paint that you're going to have to work with. So it's you're going to need some extra blue when we do the rocks and the cliff line and the mountains, I guess, is where I was going with that. I don't have to run around and give everybody paint, or have one of my family members run around and give you paint. This is kind of good because you're going to have your own paint. All right. So what I'm going to do is switch back brushes. I'm going to take some of that dark. I want this blue to be darker. Now the tricky thing here is I'm hoping that that's dry enough, because if you put wet paint on top of wet paint, it usually works as an eraser. But it's actually kind of warm in the studio, so paint is drying at a very good clip. I did. Well, I got news for that thing. So again, little mistakes, little bleed throughs and all that stuff. That happens while you're painting. I'm gonna switch to my liner brush. So I wanna kinda put in some flashy flare, some shooting stars, however that's going to look. And that thing that I just made a mistake, if anybody's been in a class with me and they've ever tried to hide a mistake that they made or try to have me correct a mistake, I usually go to that mistake and actually draw attention to it. So I'm going to do that with this. I'm taking my liner brush and I'm just making these little broken lines. And as I get down to my little bubble here, I may even cheat a little and make that really bright. You can get carried away, I guess, and make as many of these as you want to make. All right. And let's place your starlight, just a couple of little dots and dashes. All right, again, you could probably get as carried away as you want. I got a mountain to put in here, so I'm gonna get too carried away. All right. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna do is we wanna put in the areas that are green. So the evergreens in the foreground that kind of frame out this corner, this little valley that's gonna go back in here, and this cute little adornment of like smaller little pine trees are gonna go over here. So while we do that, I added some more color. So there's a dark green. There's a green oxide, and I still have blue, which may be able to be used when we blend some greens together. You can make a darker green. So first things first, I have this, I'm working with this shape in here. Well, you know that that's going to be green, but I want to make where my cliff line is going to be, and I can do that with green paint. And I'm just going to kind of make this little section there, and that's going to be this rocky little ridge of like cliff line or whatever, where these trees are going to live. I'm going to kind of map out how many trees I want, and again, it could be three. I'm going to do three because that's what the original is, but I'm going to kind of just one, two, maybe three. Okay. I'm going to use this light green to map out all my smaller little trees. This first down here, I'm sticking with my liner brush, and I'm going to begin to make this little ridge of trees. And all I'm doing is making a very small little loops with my liner brush. Wispy little half circles. Like that, like that, like that, like that, like that. I'm going to repeat that process. Some of them can be thicker, some of them can be thinner. You can even leave some space in there because I'm going to come back in with some darker paint and give some dimension to those. But I just want to map out how many trees I'm going to have and where they're going to be, their placement, their gesture, all that stuff. Maybe this one kind of goes up here. Need a little water. Again, you can put as many or as few trees as you want. You can place them where you want. Feel like I should tell jokes or something while I'm painting. I could have these, spin these long yarns of these really long jokes as I'm painting. Maybe that's something I gotta work on. I mean, that's the quickest way not to have anybody subscribe. I hope the two people that watch this video actually wind up doing a good job with this painting. I mean, I suppose I could promote my blog while I'm doing this. These are the things I think about when you're doing a little busy work. So if you were doing busy work, you could think about where you're placing your trees and all that stuff. But you don't want to think too far ahead. Otherwise, your painting starts kind of coming out contrived. But you can think a couple of steps ahead, like, you know, how you were going to place branches. And like anybody that's painted with me, you know, I have this whole spiel about thinking ahead a few steps while you're doing busy work or filling in a background. All right. I'm going to switch to my saber brush to do these bigger trees, and same stroke. And what you're going to find with your saber brush, you get really feathery strokes. So we're going to add some dark green. We might make some hybrid greens out of black and green, or blue, green, black. We're going to make some lush greens to kind of fill this in. But all we're doing at this point is just kind of placing where these trees are going to be. You can cheat a little, slow down your brush, get the coverage. Tree here. I tend to get quiet when I'm painting because, you know, I don't hear a room full of people drinking and laughing, and we'll get back there eventually. Hopefully I won't get as bat shit as Bob Ross and put a squirrel on my shoulder and let's do that. It's gonna get dense down here, so don't worry about blending all those, or how that's gonna blend together, or painting over those strokes. This can get nice and lush. Got one more little tree up here. And you've heard me say this at classes, if numerology is a thing, and it is, and you wanted to do four trees or two trees or whatever, then that's, you know, you're the author, you're the artist. You can put as many trees in there as you want. Same formula. Kind of just brushing. Taking the broad end of that brush, you get a nice stroke. use the edge of that saber brush and you get nice little lines. You can cover right over those trees. Okay. I am, with that saber brush, I'm going to rinse out some of that lighter green. I'm going to move to my dark green. I have some residual blue left over. I'm going to mix that with that phthalo green. I'm going to pull a little black. And now I'm going to add that dark. In fact, if you want to start something like that, the dense, you know, have that kind of remind yourself where those trees are going to be balanced. Again, you can cheat down here because this is dense. This is going to be this dense area. Get a handle on this, find myself a good spot, flip that over. So you always find the angle that you can get the strokes that you want to get. Unless some of you, again, might be working flat. So again, just pulling from the center out. Covering up all that pink that when we started, but having that extra layer of paint down there is actually good because that's going to kind of give a volume to the painting. Need a little bit more of that green. And again, you know, you're using the paint that you have. You might have a, you know, out of the tube, quote unquote, forest green or something like that. That'll work just as well. I like blending colors and making colors. So I'm going to make that color using phthalo blue, phthalo green, and a black. Again, I'm just kind of because those three lines I'm using as guidelines. Here, I'll flip it back over in a second. I just want to make sure that I get doing this one here. I want to make sure I cover up all that pink. Probably getting confused, so I'll flip this back over. So I'm using that as a guideline. I'm just pulling that darker color down through this dense forest. And you slow down, you tend to get a little bit better coverage down here. So there's nothing wrong with cheating a little bit. and making sure that that's kind of blended the way you want it to blend. I'm gonna switch to my liner brush, just kind of give a little detail. That same dark color. I'm gonna just add a little definition. Same thing over here. You don't have to feel compelled to go through the entire thing and every little branch get a highlight or an outline. I'm just doing a couple little, a few little spots. Same thing with these guys back here. We want to go back in and address them. Just kind of darkening those up. So just grooving on the painting, that's why I'm not saying anything. Just muddling my way through. Although I'm finding that I'm not the only one that makes bad videos in this whole coronavirus pandemic. Newscasters make lousy videos. There's technological issues as they were trying to interview people. Cooking shows. Everybody is making bad video. Seems to be the trend. All right. So again, just kind of going in. Oh, what? I guess this tree is going to be bigger. Too carried away here. Let's again, you can get kind of caught up in how many little lines and how many little edges and soft little details that you want to put in. I'll try to stop. Okay. I'm just going to take this. I'm taking this lighter green, or this oxide. I gotta kind of begin to fill in this little valley here. And how that's gonna be interpreted. And this shape is going to be different probably for everybody based on how puffy your clouds are, how that placed on your canvas. I mean, you can kind of see I'm getting in tight with my round brush. If you felt compelled to use your liner brush that works, then use that. I may come back in and add some tips to my trees, but I want to get this filled in. I mean, if this is a thing and making that kind of mark to break up some of that space, do that too. Gonna integrate some of my green, darker green. I'm gonna graffito scribble in some of that and then come back to this in a second. I suppose if somebody was, well, you do have time. Actually, if you have paints and brushes, here's a thing, I suppose a very colorful variation of this. Instead of just having this little green valley, I suppose you could put a valley of wildflowers or little points and stipples and kind of make the illusion that it's wildflowers. I am gonna drop my brush on the floor. I'm just gonna kind of go in and make all these little hash marks. So it's not like I'm making little blades of grass. I'm just making these little impressionistic little dashes and stubbly little paint marks. Tighten some of those marks up. You can. I don't know if it shows up on the video, but you got some little bright areas where canvas is bleeding through. This is where you can tighten up some of your drawing. Take some dark green. Just go back in and fill that in. Yeah, I could definitely see doing like a series of flowers or something in there. Again, you'd probably add a whole lot of time to the painting, but again, the beauty here with doing this stuff on video is that you got as much time as you need. And I know that was always something that hamstrung us in events, is when you're somewhere at a friend's house or at a lodge or a bar or restaurant, you got a couple hours to try to accomplish one of these paintings and you kind of got to go. Now you actually have time to finish the painting the way you want to finish the painting. Same thing down here. I want to get in tight. I can get in tight. Okay. So there's your little valley. All right, so the last little section that we got to do for this painting is putting in the mountain and this cliff line that's going to be in the foreground. So with my round brush or whatever brush that you feel comfortable with drawing with, we'll go ahead and map that out. I've also added a little gray. I still have white and black and a little blue, phthalo blue. And at any point you need to get any more of those paints, you're going to need a little dollop of each to kind of make the rocks different shades of gray, not just that they're all going to be gray with like black outlines around them. So I'm going to take black first, a little dollop of black on my round. And again, everybody's mountain's going to be different, different sizes, different shapes, but I'm going to start right about here. I'm going to draw this kind of crooked little triangle. And then what we're going to do is kind of fake a little pyramid. And I'm going to maybe put that right off into that shape. So again, really all that is your triangle shape split in half, or if you're looking at, put your brush on the top of it, it's a peace sign. Down here, we want to kind of mask out some of that pink. So even with black on my brush still, I'm going to dig into some, this is out of the tube gray. Obviously, you're at home, you want to play in your palette, white, black, blue, a little green, like whatever you have left on your palette, you can mix a lot of different variations of gray. You can make a cool gray, a warm gray, but I'm going to take this out of the tube gray first, and I'm going to kind of color, get rid of some of this pink, or get rid of all of this pink, actually, because this is going to be a cliff line, and it's not going to be a Willy Wonka cliff line, so it's going to actually look gray, so we want to hide. Within the drawing and within the filling, if you felt like drawing a little, you can do that too. Giving yourself some ideas about where some rocks might go. And I'm using my round brush. If you wanted to use your flat brush, I would not suggest using your detail brush. You would be here forever. You'll use your detail brush to maybe draw the lines back in, or the cracks and the rocks and all that stuff. But right now, what you're just trying to do is mask out that pink. You want to just get that on there, let that dry while we work on our mountain. Okay. We need a little bit more gray. So with that gray that I used, I'm going to take a little blue of that phthalo blue. It's kind of hard to see now, I guess, at this point. But I'm going to take that phthalo blue and mix it with gray. And again, if you made a gray out of just mixing black and white, that's fine. But I'm going to make this slate gray. Just a little blue hue to it. The thing about a mountain, it's kind of jagged, and I almost want to keep the jagged and the rhythm of the mountain in parallel to those little streaks of star streaks or star showers or whatever I got going on over there. And again, we'll probably have to get into a finer brush to get in around some of these tighter curves. But I'm really just kind of covering up over the blue. Same thing over here. So it will tighten up down here in a second. I'm doing a lot of this mixing on my palette. I'm pulling blue, a little black, mixing it with that gray. Slowly kind of blending these together. Again, I'm going slow because I'm being careful, I guess, not to drip. Drips in the early part of your painting, okay. At the end, not so much. It's manageable if it happens. Don't fret. I'm gonna hit that with some black in a second. So the other side of the mountain, well, you're always going upward towards the peak of the mountain. But I'm just trying to get a little different shapes, different textures to kind of build up that rocky mountain. And I'm going to take almost some straight black while that gray is on there and begin to give some volume, some depth, some weight to that mountain. And in fact, I think I'm going to even switch brushes. This is where my saber brush would probably come in handy. This side or the back side of your mountain, you got to kind of decide which is brighter. I mean, it seems like there's a light source on the back side of the mountain, so maybe this side's darker. But again, it's a kind of a dreamscape. Whatever you want it to be. Flash of blue in there. I'm going to switch to my saber brush. See, now your saber brush is where you can kind of get those nice little edges, sharp little peaks. So now you kind of got a good start to your mountain. Now I'm going to go midway up with some white and black. And it's going to make a lighter gray. Maybe if you want really bright, bright snow towards the top, we can accomplish that too. But right now I'm just trying to get a little. This side I think I'm going to make a little brighter. So I'm going to go a little bit more heavier on the white. Yeah, I really like the saber brush. Tricky part with this white is, or can be, before you put the white in, even though that we're kind of going to muddle it and make a lot of granite and gray and slate colored grays, you want a little crisp white at the top, so you got to make sure your water's clean for that. What? I suppose some of you might even be compelled to, you want to put a little light source in, like if you wanted to paint a moon or something, because you know that could be a thing. I like how these streaks play off into the sky. I think, unlike the original, or a little different from the original, I'm going to highlight the back side of this mountain with a little white. Okay. So I'm cool with that. So now we want to kind of get down here and finish the last little part, which is going to be this little cliff line. So this is, we're going to kind of make a little mosaic of just a little bunch of oblong shaped stones. So what I'm doing is I'm just mixing some gray, different shades of gray, so I'm making this little patchwork of stones, and we'll piece together. I even got some green left. I'm going to mix some green into that gray, because hey, I got it. Might as well use it. Just because I'm in my studio, I still have the same philosophy. It's better on the canvas than me having to take it in the house and flush it down the sink. Doing is piecing together like a mosaic these little weird shapes that kind of resemble this rocky cliff line. They don't even have to be blended well. Okay. I am, if I'm doing anything, that I'm being a little deliberate about, is that I am trying to cover up the pink that's in the background. Almost there. Okay. So, all right. I think I did everything I wanted to do, at least with that shape. Now, I'm going to go to my liner brush, and we're going to finish this off. So now I'm going to take a little straight black. And yeah, it's kind of outlining, but don't feel like you got to go every little rock. First, I'm going to kind of make my broken little line to define the base of this cliff line. Again, holding my brush. I know at events I see you guys and everybody you want to do this like you're writing, when sometimes you got better leverage just holding your brush sideways and letting the bristles do the work. A little different than drawing. I mean, you're drawing, but it's a very different instrument than using a pencil or a pen or a marker. Again, doesn't have to be super defined. Wanted to put a couple little stipples in there. Kind of make the rock seem cracked or could even add more little lines if you feel like you wanted to kind of have some smaller rocks in there. Blend that in a little. This is really kind of nearing the end. And I always say, oh, a couple more strokes and then I can wind up painting for another 10 minutes. But, you know, that's kind of my thing. All right. Like I said, you can break these shapes up kind of however you wanted them to be. I'm just going to break up these marks a little and put some different marks in there. And really? Really, that's it. I dream a mountain. I dream of a mountain. If you want to see, I'm going to kind of reach in front of the camera. So as opposed to the original, or that's where we wound up. So hopefully I'll get this video out online. You had a good time. At least you broke up your day some. Had a couple of drinks maybe. And next time around, we'll pick another painting. I guess if this is going out live on YouTube, and I would ask you to interact with me either on YouTube or Facebook, post your pictures of the paintings that you did or that we did together. Something else that you can do too is suggestions of paintings from our catalog that you would like to paint. And those individuals that have an idea, I would surely paint them with you. Until then, stay safe, keep washing your hands, keep a proper distance from everybody else around you, and I will see you in the next video.